Well, good afternoon. My name is Frédéric Kaplan, and this is Sabine Süsstrunk next to me. Actually, it would be vice versa. And we are from the EPFL, the Swiss Federal Institute of Technology. So to a certain point in these 10 minutes, we're actually going to present quite a few projects. And so do forgive us if they are short, and we're here then to talk a little bit about these projects a bit more. So we heard quite a bit about deep learning yesterday, and so I will not repeat this. But keep in mind, one of the reasons why we are here is that computer vision, and specifically machine learning, can do now for the images that it could never do before. Because I can actually now, to a certain point, you know, solve the semantic gap. And the semantic gap was basically, or is basically, the concept that there is a strong disconnect, or can be, between formal languages, like pixels, like notes, and basically the complex natural languages that that express syntax and structure and patterns. And especially in imagery or in art history, you do are looking for patterns. We all want to solve a problem, like the problem we just heard about before, about basically meeting faces. So now that we can actually skip the semantic gap, and forgive me, I'm going to skip these kind of slides, let me show you a few applications where we use this. So the first one is the Montreux Jazz Archive. The Montreux Jazz Archive is an archive that we have at EPFL. It includes more than 5,000 concerts of partly artists that have never performed any place again, the same kind of concert or the same, or in the same groups. 11,000 hours of video, 6,000 hours of audio, and 14,000 tapes. Now think about this here in the art historical world or in the Frick. These kind of archives are the archives of the future. This is basically the art archive of the future of all these videos. And here we don't have, you know, thousands, hundreds or thousands of pictures. We actually have billions of pictures. And if we want to express this or we want to search for them, we need to basically create metadata for them, and metadata that actually makes sense. And now with deep learning, we can actually do these kind of things, and let me show you an example. We have some sound, maybe. There will be some sound.
Don't you know the possibilities?
A little bit of jazz in the morning moment. So what you can do is, you know, what we've done with this, using actually a very simple pre-train method, and actually went through these videos and annotating these videos with metadata. And one of the things is it's not just metadata actually for the whole image, but metadata for parts of the image. And now what you then can do is you can start searching for these terms and actually extracting frames of the video. And we try to do this kind of extraction of the frames in the video of the sense that you can get a summary of the video, but in a pleasing way. So in other words, kind of do the Google of the Montreux Jazz Archive. And as I mentioned before, this kind of metadata is not just for a frame in itself, but also for parts of a frame. And then, of course, that allows you then to organize these videos. One other thing that this allows us to do is keep in mind that part of these videos are very old. And if you now want to show them on modern devices like this one, you also have to post-process them. And this is like one example of one of my PhD students who recently did some kind of compilation using again of upsampling without changing the look, but at least make them clear for the devices. Now, the one thing is which one you like better, the left or the right? Okay, we can okay, giving you another kind of example, and this is in the contrary of before, is this example of basically analyzing Abi Warburg's Builder Atlas, or the Mimozine Atlas, as it's also called. Now, Abi Warburg, and I don't have to introduce him to the art historians here, was a famous German art historian who, in the beginning of the 20th century, put together panels. And keep in mind, this was also the reason he could do that in the beginning of the 20th century is because the technology allowed him to make copies which was not possible before. And he tried to kind of organize, because he was a strong believer there's something like the afterlife of the antiquity. So that there is, that certain forms and certain expressions were not just present in antiquity, but actually came through the art, on the art world, through time. Now, I'm not going to explain these pictures because I'm not going to embarrass myself in front of the art historians who probably know better than me what they were. So, but this is kind of an example. And so, if I go back, just to tell you, there were 63 panels. And we started looking at this and analyzing this, and is there something in these panels or in these figures that he looked for? He also described this concept of pathos formal that can explain, that show up over and over and over again. Now, Warburg, as opposed to the talk we just heard, Warburg never talked about faces. So in our case, we basically came to the idea that it probably would be better just to look at the poses, but disregard the faces. Now, we annotated these poses manually. Today, you could do this through deep learning, and clustered them. Now, one thing that we actually found out, and this was very interesting, is that if you looked at this, all these pathos formal, all these kind of like strong emotions that he described and realized have one thing in common. They are mechanically very unstable figures. You cannot hold these poses. You cannot hold the arm up and these poses. And believe it or not, nobody else has actually ever described this before, because people or humans are very bad of extracting patterns over thousands of images at 63 panels. Once you put everything together in one slide, it's not a problem. You can see it very, very well. And here again, deep learning helped. I'm going to turn it over to Frédéric for the Replica Project.
So the Replica Project is conducted by Isabella Di Leonardo. She's an art historian which is really believing that things are going to change if we put the 99% other data of art history online and searchable, and that will be like a new era. And Benoît Seguin, which is a PhD student just currently finishing his PhD on the project, which is a big believer that deep learning can actually play a crucial role in making actually this use collection online, searchable, annotated, but also permitting to explore them in new way. And it starts from a project which is at the Cini Foundation. As you may know, it's one of the biggest photo archive in the world. You have, as many photo archive, these cardboards with description on them. I mean, typically a black and white photograph and some additional metadata. And with Adam Lowe, I mean, we design a scanner which is specifically done for that type of document, and which is, as far as we know, the fastest in the world, which is doing recto verso pictures of the, these documents, which is manipulated by 2%, is very non-alienating. And if you use that type of scanner, I mean, in less than 1 year, we had about 300,000 recto verso scans that were done, not even like in a full-time use, and without actually having to dedicate specific person to this. It came really as a natural element based on the efficiency and the niceness of the scanner. This is the first step. You get this ocean of images, and then start the interesting part. I mean, first you have to segment what is on the images, finding actually where is the photographs, finding what are the other parts. And for this, this used to be done with actual very traditional technique. Now deep learning permits to do that very easily. You actually define a mask of what are the different parts you want to train, to recognize, and the system does it automatically. So this is a system that Benoît did, which actually permitted very efficiently to extract the different parts of the images. Once you get actually to that part, you need then to use optical character recognition extraction, which is kind of state of the art. You group the words, and progressively you adapt the type of wording to the actual to the actual meaning. That means their metadata. The thing which is interesting is the level of performance. As we did that in a streamlined manner, we were capable of saying that less than 3% of the metadata which were on this cardboard were missed without human integration. That means that you go, you put in the scanner, and everything is automatic, and you get 97% of what was written actually correct in your database. Then there's something which is interesting, is that then comes the other step. I mean, you have names of artists, names of places, etc., and that you need to match with other databases. And one obvious match is the Getty Union list of artist name. Here you have 73% of match which are done automatically. The other 27% is essentially because they are not artist name. They are typically, you know, followers of the school of, I mean, all these type of grammatical elements you use in art history, which permit to describe the unknown elements of these elements. So this is again quite interesting, as it is fully automatic. And then start the interesting part. I mean, you are of course capable with new technology now to tell whether two images, although they have different size and exposure, are actually representing the same pieces of work, and that the computer does very well, including making difference with things which look really alike but which are not necessarily the same thing. If you do this on the collection, you find something interesting. First, you actually identify how many objects you have, but even more interesting, if you combine that with metadata, you discover for the first time that in a collection like that, there are more than 1,000 images which have conflicting metadata, conflicting author names. And nobody knew about that, and nobody could know about that, because if you would go actually in the drawers, you would pick one artist, you would find a painting, you say, okay, that's an artist of that painting. In that million photograph, I mean, what is the chance that actually you already remember that you've seen that particular picture in another drawer assigned to somebody else? That is almost impossible in that type of size. This is coming up automatically. Doesn't mean this is bad, but that means that these 1,000 cases should be looked pretty precisely. This is the interface which actually you can access. We put replica, dhlabdemo.org, username frick, password frick underscore replica. I mean, it's not public, I mean, in the sense that it's under a login, but please use these temporary account to look at it. It's a simple way. You start with a text search, you get an image, and then you do an image search. Here, for instance, starting from the prototypal Venus of Giorgio, you found a lot of images which are not labeled as Venus. I mean, this could be Cleopatra, this could be a nymph, but obviously, I mean, they share something which is much beyond, of course, pixel matches, which is something about composition, subject, which is that particular form of morphology which is shared among all these images. And this is one way of representing that type of search. The other way, which is interesting here, for instance, if I search a theme like the word Doge, I mean, we're working a lot on Venice, you will find actually all the documents which are matching this word, but then you cluster them in a form of automatic regroupment based on the similarity distance, which is computed based on these deep learning features. Here, for instance, you will match both elements regarding the actual subject, but also elements regarding the fact that they were published, for instance, here in the same book, and you find the different types of clothes that the Doge was wearing. And if you look carefully and if you play with the system, you will discover actually that the system is very good in meting matching, which are actually going cross-modality between drawings, print, sculpture. I mean, you will actually find that things are the same or are similar. In the case you find here, you would see a representation of the Doge and a drawing of the Doge, and they are close together despite the fact that one is a sculpture and the other is a drawing. So I encourage you just to try replica.dhlabdemo.org, frick underscore replica. We'll also do demo during the break. Thank you very much.